Welcome to Study Time, a televised home learning program produced by Rwanda Education Board.
Hello, students. Welcome to TV Learning Program. My name is Benon. I will be taking Senior 1 students in biology. Dear students, when we talk about biology, then we think about living organisms, because the subject is meant for the study of living organisms. Here we talk about plants and animals. Students, let us see some amazing facts about human body. Here are some questions we are going to discuss. Question number one. Name three organs which consume a lot of oxygen in our body. Students, remember our body needs oxygen. Can you tell me which organs consume a lot of oxygen in our body? I'm giving you a few seconds to think about them. Have you got them? Excellent. We have liver. We have brain. And the heart. This is very nice. The liver, the brain, and the heart are three organs in our body which consume a lot of oxygen. Remember, the brain controls all activities of our body. It needs a lot of energy. To get that energy, there's a lot of respiration done by brain cells. In that process, there's need for oxygen. Remember, the liver does a lot of activities. One of them is detoxification, destroying toxic chemicals in our body. Even the drugs we consume when we are sick, after they have performed their functions, they are destroyed by the liver. The liver converts glucose to glycogen, and then glycogen can be stored. Some vitamins are stored in the liver. The liver produces cholesterol, which is needed in the formation of cell membranes. The liver produces some vitamins. Bile is produced in the liver. Can you see that the liver does a lot of activities? Those activities need a lot of energy, and that energy is produced by the process of respiration, which needs oxygen. The liver uses a lot of oxygen. Students, the human heart pumps blood to all parts of the body. And in that process, there's need for energy. That's why the heart needs oxygen. Three organs consume a lot of oxygen we breathe in. Excellent. Thank you for giving good answers. Question number two, the largest organ of the human body. Do you know the largest organ of the human body? I give you time to think about it. What is it? The skin. The skin is the largest organ of the body. We have the skin. Students, what is the largest gland in our body? That is question number three. What is the largest gland in our body? Remember, the body has very many glands. Which one is the largest? It is the liver. Excellent. The liver is the largest gland in our body because, remember, it produces a lot of bile. Bile which is stored in the gallbladder. Bile which is very important in digestion of fats. Question number four. How many blood groups in ABO system? How many blood groups do you know in ABO system? Yes, we have blood group. We have blood group A. We have blood group B. We have blood group AB. We have blood group O. Those are four different blood groups. Students, question number 5. How many chambers in the human heart? How many chambers does the human heart have? The human heart has 4 chambers. Remember, it has the left side and the right side. So these chambers are divided into atria. Remember, there is left atria and right atria. Left atrium and right atrium. Then there is left ventricle and right ventricle, which means 2 atria and 2 ventricles. That makes 4 chambers of the heart. Question number 6. Students, what is the mixed gland of the human body? Which gland do we have in our body? We call a mixed gland. Excellent. The pancreas. The pancreas is considered as a mixed gland. We consider it as a mixed gland because it is endocrine in the process of producing insulin and glucagon hormones. Then it is exocrine gland because it secretes pancreatic juice. In that case, we say pancreas is a mixed gland. Students, question number 7. What is the weight of the brain? What is the average weight of the brain? What is the average weight of the brain? Do you know it? It's about 1.5 kilograms. That means the brain weighs about 1.5 kilograms. Remember, this is a very important organ of our body because it coordinates all activities of our body. Question number 8. Which is the longest bone in the human body? The longest bone. We have very many bones in our body. Which one is the longest? Excellent. It is called femur. After this, which one is the next? We can have tibia. Do you know this bone? We can have fibula as the third, and then we can have humerus. Students, these are the longest bones we have in our body. But the longest one of all is the femur. Who can tell us another name of the femur? It's called thigh bone. Who can tell us another name of tibia? This one is called shin bone. Then we have fibula, which is the lower leg. Then we have humerus, which is the upper arm. Those are the longest bones in our body. Question number 9. Which is the smallest bone of the human body? The smallest bone is? Where do we find it? We find it in the ear. Very good. How do we call that smallest bone? We call it malleus. And remember, apart from malleus, which is the smallest bone in the body, we have also incus, and then we have steps. These are the three small bones we have in. These are the three small bones we have in our body, but the most or the smallest of all is the steps. Steps is the smallest bone in our body. Then malleus has another name. We can call it hammer. We can call incus anvi. And then steps, we can call it stirrup. Those are other names that can be used to mean our three small bones in our body. Malleus can be called hammer. Hammer. And then incus can be called anvi. And then steps can be called stirrup. These are the three small bones in our body. Students, question number 10. Which organs filter about 45 gallons of blood per day? Which organs in our body filter blood? Which can filter about 45 gallons? Here, we talk about kidneys. Kidneys are very important in blood filtration. And when we talk about 1 gallon, 1 gallon is about 4.5 liters. That means kidneys can filter about 45 gallons of blood per day. Now, students, these are some of the amazing facts about our body. If you were able to answer most of these questions, I give you a big, big, big clap. I also give you flowers. Why have I given you flowers? Because flowers are important reproductive organs of our body. In addition to that, they have a good scent, good smell. So that means flowers, flowers, flowers. You deserve them. Now, students, let us quickly talk about the skeletal system, where most of the questions we saw have come from. Our lesson is human skeletal system. And by the end of this lesson, make sure you know or you're able to explain different types of skeletons, to state functions of skeletal system, and characteristics of hydrostatic skeleton, exoskeleton, and endoskeleton. Students, how many types of skeletons do we have in living organisms? Here we have 3 types. We have endoskeleton, we have exoskeleton, we have hydrostatic skeleton. When we talk about hydrostatic skeleton, this one is in organisms like cnidarians, flatworms, nematodes, and annelids. These organisms have what we call cavity in their body, where we find the fluid. And this fluid is the one that contributes to the movement of the organisms moving forward. So this is called hydrostatic skeleton. And then we also have what we call exoskeleton. Exoskeleton, this one, we can find it in organisms like mollusks, arthropods, and insects. And this exoskeleton, it is made up of chitin. Chitin, and this exoskeleton is for protection, strength, and flexibility. This exoskeleton cannot grow. So what happens when organisms need to grow or increase in size? They do what we call molting. Molting, this is how we rate it. Or this is about shedding the external parts of the skeleton. And then in this, after molting, the organism becomes soft and it is able to increase in size. Then the 3rd type of skeleton is endoskeleton, which is hard and supports organisms like mammals. This is where we find bones inside the body or internal structure. It is responsible for support and shape. It offers no external protection. That's why when you fall down, you can have injuries on your body muscles. So there are 3 types of skeletons: hydrostatic skeleton, exoskeleton, and endoskeleton. Students, let us quickly talk about the human skeleton. Very big question. When you get a baby who is just young, 2 or 3 weeks born, and then you get an old person who has 40 years, who do you expect to have many bones? The baby or the old person? Excellent, the baby, because the baby baby has about 300 bones, while the old person has only 206 bones. Can you imagine this? The baby has many bones compared to an old person. So in a few minutes, you will tell me the reason why. The human skeleton has bones, it has cartilage, it has ligaments and tendons for supporting the body structures. Then, the reason why the baby has many bones compared to adult person is because bones are not yet fused in a baby. But when a person grows up to adolescent stage, bones start to fuse together, to fuse together, to fuse together. That's why in an old person, bones are very few compared to the baby. The baby has 300 bones, and the old person has only 206 bones. Let us see some of those bones. Here we have some bones that make the human body, and they're about 206 for an old person. We have the cranium. This is the skull. Actually, we have to know the difference between the skull and the cranium. When we talk about the skull, we mean all the bones of the head. And then when we talk about the cranium, we mean the bones which protect the brain, the upper bones. Then we have the vertebra, which is part of the spinal cord. Then we have what we call ribs. These are the ribs, which are attached to the sternum. Do you know another name for the sternum? Breastbone. Then we have scapula here. We have humerus, we have called the upper bone. We have the pelvic bone, or these are the pelvic girdles, the bones of the pelvic girdles. Then we have radius and ulna. Then from there we have carpals, metacarpals, and these are called phalanges. Then from there we have the femur, which I've said this is the longest bone in our body. You can also call it thigh bone. To those who play football, you have ever heard people talking about thigh injury, that a footballer has got a thigh injury. That means the femur or the thigh bone has injury. Then we have patella. This is patella we find here in the knee. From there we have tibia or the shin bone, where footballers put shin guards to protect them from injury. Then we have fibula. Fibula, this is another bone, or the lower leg. From there we have, these are tarsals, metatarsals, and phalanges. Those are some of the bones in our body. Then from there, the human skeletal system can be divided into what we call axial and appendicular skeleton. When we talk about axial and appendicular skeleton, we will see that the axial skeleton consists of the skull, the vertebral column, and thoracic cage, while appendicular skeleton consists of the pectoral and pelvic girdles, the limb bones, the bones of the hands and feet. All those make appendicular skeleton. Students, when we talk about four limbs, we mean arms, and when we talk about hind limbs, we mean legs. So this is appendicular skeleton. You can see it has the four limbs, which are the arms, the hind limbs, which are the legs, then pelvic and pectoral girdles. Those make appendicular skeleton. When it comes to axial skeleton, we talk about bones of the skull. We talk about bones of the rib cage. This is the rib cage. Then we talk about the vertebral column or spinal cord. Those are the bones which make axial skeleton. Then different bones have different shapes. We have what we call long bones. Those are bones which are long. Example, arm Bones of the arm, bones of the legs, fingers, and toes. Then we have what we call short bones. Those are bones of carpals, tarsals, and patella. Patella, we can also call it kneecap. Then we have what we call flat bones, like the sternum or the breastbone. The ribs, the skull bones, and scapula are flat bones. We also have irregular bones, which are the vertebrae, the sphenoid, and ethmoid. This one, we find it, ethmoid is found in the nose. Then the sphenoid is found in the head, and the vertebrae makes the spinal cord. Those are irregular bones. Then here, in addition to bones, we have what we call cartilage, we have ligament, and tendon. When we talk about cartilage, we mean the soft part of the bone. And when we talk about ligament, the function of ligament is to connect a bone to a bone. You see, this is a bone, and this is another bone. They are connected by ligament. Then when we talk about tendon, the function of tendon is to connect a bone and a muscle. Tendon connects a muscle to a bone. Then from there, let us see nicely those parts we have talked about. This one is articular cartilage. When we say articulation, we mean joint. Remember, the joint is the place which connects a bone to a bone. This is the cartilage, the soft part of the bone. Then we have ligament. The function of the ligament is to connect this bone to this bone. This, you can see, this one is the ligament. Then we have tendon. Tendon connects a bone to a muscle. You can see this is a muscle. Tendon connects a muscle to a bone. Then here, we have what we call synovial cavity. And the function of synovial cavity is to produce synovial fluid. The synovial fluid is a liquid we find in between the bones, and its function is to act as a shock absorber, to protect or to prevent bones from colliding, because this can cause pain. So to avoid that, we have cartilage, which is the soft part of the bone, but we also have synovial fluid to make that place wet and soft. Students, what are the functions of skeleton? Skeleton is very important. One of the functions of the skeleton is to determine the shape of the organism. The shape of an organism. The shape of an organism. Then another function is to provide support and movement of the organism. The organism can move from one place to another because of skeleton. Then from there, we have protection and storage function. At the beginning, we talked about organs like liver, brain, and the heart, the organs which consume a lot of oxygen, and they are very important. These organs are delicate, so they must be protected by bones of the skeleton. Like the rib cage protects the heart and lungs. Cranium protects the brain. So the functions of the bones is protection and storage. Why do we say storage? Remember, within the brain, we find there are minerals. Minerals like calcium, phosphorus, those minerals are needed by our body. Then bones serve another important function, which we call production of blood cells. In the bone, we have what we call bone marrow. And in the bone marrow, the function of the bone marrow is to produce blood cells. Do you remember blood cells? White blood cells, red blood cells, and platelets. They perform different functions. So those cells are produced by what we call stem cells or undifferentiated cells we find in the bone marrow of bones. This is common in flat bones, we have seen. That's where some cells are produced, in flat bones and long bones, which means skeleton protects the internal organs, stores and releases fat, production of blood cells, store and releasing minerals like calcium and phosphorus, facilitating the movement. We are able to move from one place to another because of skeleton. Then skeleton supports the body. Students, this is the mineral composition of our bones. We have what we call cellular components or cells within our bones. We have what we call osteoblasts. We have what we call osteoclasts. We have what we call osteocytes. These are very important in bone deposition and resorption. Then we have inorganic matter, those which are not organic. Those are the minerals we talked about, calcium and phosphorus. Combined with oxygen, they form what we call calcium phosphate, which is hydroxypatite. Then we have organic matrix. With the organic matrix, we have what we call collagen and fibrins. These are proteins we find in our bones, and they form what we call amorphous mucopolysaccharide substances. Those are some of the protein substances we find in our bones. We can find their collagen protein. We can find their fibrins. Those are very important. Those make what we call the composition of the bone. Dear students, we have talked about the human skeleton. We have seen axial and appendicular skeleton. We have also talked about three types of skeleton: hydrostatic skeleton, exoskeleton, and endoskeleton. We have seen different functions of the skeleton, like protecting internal delicate organs of the body, movement, determining the shape of the body. The bone marrow produces cells. Now, let us have homework to test our level of understanding, to test your level of understanding. List three types of skeleton. Question number one. Question number two, explain functions of human skeleton. Question number three, what is the difference between endoskeleton and exoskeleton? Question number four, what is the difference between ligament and tendon? Question number five, what is the longest bone in the human body? Question number six, explain the role of skeletal system in protecting internal delicate organs of the body. Thank you very much for your participation. Do your homework and enjoy the rest of the day. Bye.